Okay, could we be up standing, please? Could we stand, please?
Welcome, everyone. Just going to begin by opening in prayer. Lord, on this day that we say our farewell to Mary, I pray for her beloved family that your peace that surpasses all understanding will be with them as they grieve the loss of their loved one. Let the memories that they treasure bring them comfort in times of reflection as they remember her life that impacted and blessed so many people. May her legacy live on in their hearts and minds as they grieve their loss. Amen. Please be seated. We're gathered here today to remember Mary Rose Taylor, who was born on the 28th of September 1951 and sadly passed away on the 17th of October 2023, leaving behind surviving husband Paul Taylor, son Mark Taylor, daughter-in-law Della, and her daughter Chelsea, grandchildren Kira, Keziah, and Khaleesi, leaving behind surviving sister Margaret Talbot and Gordon Whitehouse. We're now going to listen to the first hymn chosen by the family. Thank you, Jane.
Thank you.
Amen. I'm going to begin some tributes now. We've got Pastor Shane. Thank you. Followed by June Fisher, who are going to give some testimonies about their memories of Mary.
Good afternoon. Just first and foremost, it's a privilege and it's an honor to be just speaking a little bit about our sister Mary today. We have a church in Willenhall, Gypsy and Travellers Church, and approximately about 20 years ago, Paul and Mary came there. And we're challenging people at best, and we do take a bit of getting used to. But one of the first experience I had with Mary, she came and she enjoyed the service, Paul and Mary. And she asked if she could become a member. And I'd never heard of such a thing, becoming a member of a church. I said, you know, once you're saved, it's the blood that gives us access to the membership. We haven't come to a social club or joined a gym, that type of thing. And so that was the very first experience that I can remember when I think back over 20 years. Mary was very, very good to me, Paul and Mary, but Mary, they both were very, very good to me as a pastor. I was a young pastor then at the time, 25, 30 years ago. I was a young pastor at the time. And then they were experienced Christians then. They knew the ups and downs of being a pastor and the different things, you know. And they both of them made themselves available to me. They worked during the day and they said, you can have the keys to our home. Come if you want time by yourself. I remember it very, very vividly. And I found her a very straight woman, a very straight person. And I like that. You knew where you stood. I don't mean ignorant, I mean straight, there's a difference. And she was very straight. And she was always very, very supportive to me, always very supportive. And I mean that, I'm not just saying it just to make you feel nice today, I really mean that. She liked our style of the gospel, Christ crucified, risen from the dead. Only one way back to the Father, only through Jesus Christ and no other way. She loved that approach, and I'm sure we do today. And she was always very honest with me. Did we agree all the time? No, only a couple of different things, but minor, nothing. But she was a blessed woman. I can remember when Paul and Mary took us out for food, for a meal, fed us regular. God's people. And even today, when some of the young sisters who are now married in their 30s get up and share, they share the testimony, because they was doing the Sunday school in our church, they share the testimony of the impact that Paul and Mary had on them. So today, there's just a proverb just that reminded me of Mary that just I'll share very briefly in Proverbs chapter 17 and verse 22, and it says, a joyful heart is good medicine, but a broken spirit dries up the bones. And that reminded me of Mary. She was always positive. During that time in our church, when they were there, we had some major issues. And she would always come to me, she'd always say, Shane, press on, push through. God is good. He'll build his church. Always positive. And if any trouble causes came in that she recognized, and I can remember again, she straight to that person. I can remember like yesterday, when everybody was a bit tentative, she went straight to them. She said, you're of the devil. And that was the approach. I remember it like yesterday. She was straight. She was supportive. She really, really was. And the family, Mark, I know Mark, I know Paul. She'll be greatly missed, but she's beat us there. Amen. And for the believer today, death for the believer today is just falling asleep. We're the ones who suffer back here. I get that. You know, but one day, glory to God, for those who know Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior, one day we'll be reunited. And that's the hope of the resurrection. I love Mary, and I don't speak in past tense, because quite honestly, she's more alive now than she ever was. God bless you all.
Thank you, Pastor, for that.
I give glory to God today. Praise the Lord. Well, I've known Mary for quite some years, and we got really close to each other and we became best friends. And Mary, she inspired me and she was so special to me and I miss her so much, but I know where she is. And she was an encourager. She just encouraged me so much and inspired me, and not only me, but everybody who she spoke to. She was an encourager. And she was so kind and caring and giving. And even down to that, she loved her knitting and her crocheting. And even that, she was giving. She, at our Connect group, she would say, "I've knitted you a cardigan." And I had a mustard colour one, and Natalie had a purple, and many others that she gave away. And she used to crochet blankets and give them away. Yeah. I've got my blanket out over the last week because of the way it's cold. And I call it Mary's blanket of many colours because it was so pretty. And I'll treasure that. And like every day, we used to call each other up, 3 times a day sometimes. But on the morning, we used to speak on the phone for a good hour. And Mary loved a Spurgeon book, and she brought me one. And like we used to discuss what the message was in that day, for that day. And like we used to just encourage each other in the Lord. And in the background, she used to make me laugh because in the background I could hear Paul trying to get in on the conversation. And Mary would say, "Just a minute, June." She'd say, "Will you shut up?" Right. And Paul would say, "Well, if I have to wait an hour after you pair finish talking, I will forget what I've said." I didn't feel sorry for him, really. But you know what? Mary, there'll never be nobody like Mary again. And I just give thanks to God for that time that I had with Mary and that the time that we spent together. And I just praise the Lord at the fact that I've got those memories that will always stay with me. And I felt privileged and honoured to have a friend like Mary. And I know it's a cliche when they say the Lord only takes the best, but to me, she was the best. And I miss her so much. But she has inspired me and encouraged me. And yes, she has left an impact on everybody she spoke to because she was special. She was a strong woman of faith and she never wavered from what she believed. And I praise God for that, because she has really inspired me. And I just give glory to God that it was a privilege of knowing Mary as my best friend. I feel so honoured. And she will always be with me forever. And to Paul and to Mark and to Della, you're in my prayers. And I pray that the Lord will bless you and that he will strengthen you and that he will comfort you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, June. Okay, we've got the second song chosen by the family. Don't give up, you're on the brink of a miracle.
Thank you.
Okay, we've got some more tributes now, beginning with Joy Hamilton. If you'd like to come forward, followed by Kevin Mohan and then David Colston.
Good afternoon, everyone. Condolences to the General and Mark and the rest of the family. I call him the General because he's a general in the army of God. In the midst of turmoils and whatever was going on in his life, he was witnessing every moment that he had in the midst of the heartaches and whatever, and I admire you. But I'm standing here to speak about the Duchess. I call Mary the Duchess because she's such a woman. I thank God that I met her. I thank God for the inspiration that she has been to me. And as I do speak about the blanket, when I first met her, she said the Holy Spirit told her to knit me a prayer blanket. And no matter how much I dress my bed, that blanket goes back on top. It doesn't leave me. She was encouraging. If we had a phone call and I said the slightest little thing that goes wrong, she said, we are going to get on our knees right now and we're going to pray. And I know for a fact that she always gets on her knees and I see answer to prayers. And I thank God that I met this lady because she was totally, totally sold out for God. And as someone said, she's straight. You know where you stood with her, but she was straight. But I just want to sing something. Praise God. There's a land of endless days, lies a city four square. And they count the time by years, for there is no night there. God shall wipe away all tears. There'll be no death, no pain, no fear. For they count the time by years. For there is no night there. Steal away. Steal away, steal away to Jesus. Steal away, steal away home. We ain't got long to stay. So steal away, steal away, steal us, steal away, steal away home. We ain't got long to stay. The Lord, he calls you by the thunder, yea. The trumpet sound within my soul. We ain't got long to stay here. The Lord, he calls. He calls by the lightning, yea. The trumpet sound within my soul. We ain't got long to stay here. So steal away, steal away. Steal away to Jesus. Steal away, steal away home. We ain't got long to stay here. My Lord, he calls by the lightning, yeah. My Lord, he calls by the thunder, yea. The trumpet sound within my soul. We ain't got long to stay here. So steal away. Steal away, steal away to Jesus. Steal away, steal away home. We ain't got long to stay here. Hallelujah.
Thank you. Kevin Mohan.
Before I say my piece, Mark's asked me to say a few words he wrote down about his mum. My mum. She was the best mum any son could have asked for the 50 years of my life. Me and my mum were such alike. Our personalities often clashed on our stubborn ways. But she always was the first to offer me an olive branch. Then it was like nothing had ever happened. If my mum liked you, she liked you and would give you her last penny. But if she didn't like you, she would let you know. She didn't. My mum loved a laugh and joked, and we played many practical jokes on each other over the years. She had such an amazing, funny laugh, which many of you in here today will remember. I will miss that laugh for the rest of my life. Today, we say goodbye to her, but she will be with me in my heart forever. I'm the person today because of my mum, and will always be that person she wanted me to be. Every decision I make now, I will think, would my mum be okay with that? Goodbye, mum. I love you and always will. Your son, Mark. Now, I'll keep mine a bit shorter than that. In loving memory of Mary, a devoted wife, cherished mother to her only son Mark, and a dear friend who affectionately called me her second son. Amen. Mary's life was a testament to her unwavering love for her family and her deep faith in God. She leaves behind a legacy of warmth, kindness, and a profound connection to those she held dear. May her spirit rest in eternal peace.
David?
Well, good afternoon, or good morning if you got here before 12. Me and my wife Leslie have known Mary for about 30 years through various churches. And you notice, first of all, I want to say three thank yous. One to Paul and family for giving me the privilege of being here. The other two is for Mary. Thank you, Mary, for such a lovely day. And for giving me the opportunity to put this suit back on again, which I haven't worn since my mother's funeral about 15 years ago. So, and you know what? Still fits. But thank you. Mary, there'll be people in this church today who are friends, they're relatives, they've passed by Mary, Mary's passed by their lives just for a fleeting moment. And every one of us who's done that has been affected by her in some way. And what I would say is, to some people this sounds really, really bad. It's a sad day, but for a believer with faith, it's the end of the product. And whenever you hear us talk about Mary, you will also hear about Paul, because you cannot separate them. Mary was fun. We had the privilege of going away with her on a couple of holidays. And we went to Blackpool a couple of times. And if I tell you Mary's and Paul's itinerary when they were anywhere, it had to be where there were shops. You couldn't go on a riverside and sit in a chair. You had to be a shop. And the way it went was two shops and a cup of tea. Two shops and a cup of tea. Two shops and a cup of tea. Every time. We went to Blackpool a couple of times, and it was just like that. And we favoured one little cafe in the square, the Blue Cafe, and it was lovely. And in 1 year, we've got a military family, and we've been going to Normandy for the D-Day celebrations for 40 years. And we persuaded Paul and Mary and June and a couple of other friends to come with us about 4 or 5 years ago. And there we were, first day, in a town called Bayeux, yes, the tapestry town, okay. And true to his word, within 5 minutes, we were outside a cafe on the pavement for a cup of tea. So we all ordered our cups of tea, and it was a pot of hot water, a little bit of milk, and a tea bag. After about 3 minutes, Mary had dispensed with the first tea bag because she drank it out about 20 times and there was nothing coming out of it. So she waved to the young lady in the cafe. You're laughing, Paul. You remember what's coming, right? And the lady came out. She said, can I have a... another tea bag? Yes, of course. So the lady came out with a tea bag and she held it up in front of Mary. Mary went to grab it off her and she went, that'll be €1. And Mary went, that's £1? She said, if I put 50p to it, I could get a box of 80 from Tesco's. Anyway, knowing that it was the only way out, she took the tea bag and she handed over the euro. She got about 4 cups of tea out of that last tea bag. But we had great fun. We never went back. I only spoke to Mary just earlier this year, and I said, we're going back to Blackpool because we had a favourite boarding house. She said, no, she says, I ain't going back there again ever in my life. She says, they've shut the calf. So we never went back to Blackpool. And we had a great time in France. But whenever we went with Mary, it was fun. And in the end, even though she got angry, she never stopped talking about this tea bag for about 3 weeks. But in the end, she saw the fun. And she was always making fun of herself. And that was the thing. She realised that she was human. But the biggest thing about Mary and Paul is not that they're believers, because there's a lot, everybody in this church at this moment is a believer in something. But they don't believe on its own. They have the faith that goes with the belief. And she encouraged all of us who know her so much that this is a sad day, but it's also a joyful day. Because we're saying goodbye to a mortal body. And right now, I've had this discussion with Paul earlier this week. Right now, and we've had a really good laugh, haven't we, Paul? Right now, Mary is sitting there at the feet of Jesus. And she's saying, I want a cup of tea. And if you try and charge me €1, there won't have to be some trouble. Mary, we don't have to bless you. You've been blessed. You're blessing us now. We're the ones with the work to do. You've done your bit, and now you're getting your reward. So, on behalf of Mary and Paul, bless all of you, and just remember, the one thing that Mary always said, she said two things. She said, the last thing she said to me and my wife when she was in hospital was, trust in the Lord. And the one thing that they always said was the last, I can't remember where it is in the Bible, I think it's Matthew, and it is, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and everything will be added to you.
Thank you, Daniel. Thank you all for your tributes. I'm sure Mary would have been very grateful for what you've said about her. Before I close off with my address, we've just got one more hymn of all the things this world can give. Thank you.
My heart is out, my feet so sorry, cry. Right.
Mary. When I went to see Paul and Mark as we were planning the funeral, they informed me that Mary was born in Bilston. She's a black country lass. And went to school in Everidge, was it? Everidge in Bilston. Most of her working life was at Josiah Parks Locks Company for 30 years, where she was a powder coater sprayer. And I asked Paul and Mark about some of their memories of Mary, and both agreed, and we've already heard it, she spoke her mind. You knew where you stood with Mary. And I prefer people who are straight with me, to be honest. As it's been said by David, she always went to Blackpool on holiday until COVID. Mark told me she loved going to other churches as well. And Paul and Mary love shopping together. Amen. You had no choice but to go, mate. And she loved autumn. And Paul sent me a picture of autumn leaves. And she liked the seasons, especially autumn. She had a brother called David, and they would prank each other, so I'm told. On one occasion, Mary told David to come in fancy dress to a party that wasn't a fancy dress party. And he came looking like a bumblebee. No one else was in fancy dress, so you could imagine his face as he walked in. But I heard Mary got a cake in her face. Apparently they were always pranking each other. On one occasion, I think it was Mary's 40th, David sent a stripper to a party, and Mary wasn't best pleased. So she got her own back and sent some workmen to dig up his drive. Could imagine his face. She was a prankster, wasn't she? Obviously. And I've got personal fond memories of Mary, if I'm honest. She was very encouraging, as Paul is too. And I remember saying to Mary, because we were talking about the different gifts that are given to the church, and I said to Mary, yours is encouragement. I said, because since I've known you, all you've done is encourage me all the time. And there would be many Sundays after I'd finished my preach and I'd gone home, and I'd get a text message or a voice message, or I'd miss the call because I was tucking into my lunch, and it would be from either Paul or Mary. Most of the time, Mary saying, "Pastor, that was fantastic this morning." Amen. And that's the way she was. She was always encouraging. She's always saying, if there's anything I can pray for, please let me know. I pray for you all the time. I pray for you every day. I pray for the church every day. That was Mary. She was also very generous and blessed me many, many times with her generosity. If she had something on her mind, she would approach me and we would discuss it. Me and Mary didn't always agree. We didn't always agree on everything, but neither of us held a grudge. And I remember one conversation we had, and we said, well, we're just going to have to agree to disagree on this one. What was she like when I saw her the next time? It was like nothing had ever happened. That was Mary. And I loved and I respected Mary. I really did. Grew to know her. She was hospitable. We had barbecues around at your house where she invited some of us to go across and enjoy food together. She loved to put a spread on for people to enjoy. And she had a lovely kept home as well, kept garden. That was Mary and Paul. And when I went to visit her in hospital, her first concern was how I was, how Vicky was, and how the church was. Not thinking about herself, but thinking about other people. She also took time to tell me about the divine appointments that she had in the hospital. She was going through sickness, she was going through pain, but she wanted to tell me about her telling the doctors about Jesus, the nurses about Jesus, the consultants about Jesus, the porters about Jesus, the patients opposite in the bed next to her about Jesus. And she said to me, the lady over there, I led her to Jesus yesterday. That was Mary. Even with all the pain that she was in, she still had a sense of humor. And that was what I loved about her. She preached the gospel and she prayed for all who would listen. Little did she know that the hospital was going to be her final mission field. While I was at the hospital, we talked and she said, you know, I've got a testimony, Pastor, when I come out, I want to get up there and I want to tell the people. But as I sat and listened to Mary, I just had this feeling deep inside that this was going to be her final resting place. I commend her for her heart for people to come to know Christ right up till her last breath. And on the day that she died, I sat along Mark with Paul and Mark by her bed. At this stage, she was able to verbally communicate, but she was fully aware of what was going on and the conversations that we were having. I learned I leaned into to Mary because I wanted to say a few things to her. I wanted to thank her for all the encouragement that she gave to me. I also spoke scripture in her ear and over her. And she tried her best to communicate, didn't she? And we were saying, no, you don't have to say anything. Just relax. And one thing I do remember, what Mary asked me to do, she says, make sure you preach the gospel at my funeral. And that was her request, and I'm going to honor that this morning. And as I walked away from the hospital bed and got back in my car, one word was going through my mind. It was the word resurrection. And that word simply means rising from the dead. That's what resurrection means. Do you know, if it was God's will, he could raise Mary up from that coffin now. However, I sense Mary would complain and say, I ain't going back. I'm happy where I am. Amen. You see, as Christians, we have a hope. And that hope is the fact that because Jesus died for us on the cross and was resurrected from the dead, we have a hope that one day we will also be resurrected. Amen? Amen? As scripture says, we will be resurrected. And the day is coming when we will live with Christ for all eternity in his kingdom. Jesus said, I'm going to prepare a place for you. And when I've got this place ready, I'm going to come back so you can be with me. And here's a beautiful thing. The curse of sin was broken through Jesus' death. There is no sickness or disease in heaven. You see, Jesus said, all the old manner of things are going to pass away and the new will come. And that gives us all hope this morning and helps us to grieve with the knowing that this sense of loss isn't the final word. The body in the coffin Mary left on the day she breathed her last breath. Her new body will never decay. Amen. It will never get sick. It will live for all eternity. And in a billion years of eternity, there will be no sickness in those who believe in Christ. We have a hope that one day we will be reunited, not just with Mary, but the loved ones who've gone before us, who've died and gone into the presence of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Here's the truth. God calls all who live on this earth to put their hope and faith in Jesus Christ, to give their lives to Him, to repent of their sins that separate us from God. That word repent is a word that the secularists and the humanists are trying to get banned in the public space because people get offended. But they'll never stop me from preaching the truth of what the gospel says. And this morning, and I've heard it said so many times, so-and-so was a good person. Surely they've gone to heaven, and this person was a good person. All they did was good all their lives. And you may even argue and say, I'm a good person. I've lived a good life. Why do I need to give my life to Jesus? And Romans 3:23, it says this, for everyone has sinned. That means everyone has sinned. We all fall short of God's glorious standard. That's what the Bible says. And that scripture is saying every one of us who are guilty of sin, every one of us are guilty of sin. Not one of us can boast about how good we are. You see, when we think about how good we are, that's pride. It's nothing to do with human effort. You see, human effort will never pay the sin debt that hangs over every single one of us. And Jesus paid the debt when He died on the cross for our sins. He was stretched out on the cross. They drove nails into His hands and feet. They pierced His side. They put a crown of thorns on His head. And yet, when He was being tried, what did Pilate say? I found no fault in this man. But Jesus knew He had to go to the cross so that everyone would have the opportunity to be saved. And Romans 6:23 says this, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. What does that mean? This means death here on earth doesn't have to be the end, but rather the beginning of eternal life through Jesus Christ. And as one of our brothers says, it's only through Christ that we will find salvation. You can't earn that which is offered for free. All those who accept Jesus' invitation to be free from the curse of sin will be resurrected and be with Him for all eternity, like Mary. The Bible says that the day is coming when every human who's ever lived and who will be alive on the earth when Jesus comes through the clouds will give an account of their lives. Every one of us will stand before the judgment seat of Christ, and we will all give an account of our lives. And the greatest question that you will be asked by God is, what did you do with my son? Did you accept him? Did you accept this free gift? Or did you reject this free gift? Here's the deal. You're free to do what you want. When we were made, we weren't made as robots. God loves you so much that He gives you a free will so that you can choose whether you want to be with Him in heaven or in eternity in hell. You see, God would have it that no man or woman will perish, but that all will come to know Him. Romans 10:13 says this, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And the Apostle Paul, in his letter to Timothy, 2 Timothy 4, verse 6, it says this, as for me, and just imagine as I read this, that Mary wrote this. As for me, my life has already been poured out as an offering to God. The time of my death is near. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. And I've remained faithful. And now the prize awaits me, the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on the day of his return. And the prize is not just for me, but for all who eagerly look forward to his appearing. That was written by the Apostle Paul. It could be written by any born-again believer as they come to the end of their life. And the Apostle Paul knew that he would soon be put to death for the faith as he penned those words. The time has come for my departure. And the time will come when each of us will be called for our departure. Unless Jesus comes while we're here on the earth. And the Greek word in this text that is translated departure was a term that was often used by ancient sailors. It meant a time for the unmooring of a ship. Paul was speaking of a ship that was about to depart. A ship that would be unmoored from the land and would be freed to set sail. In Paul's lifetime, when a ship would leave the harbor, many would gather at the harbor side and they would watch the ship until it had sailed over the horizon. Have you ever done that? Stood near the waterfront as a ship sailed over the horizon. And as the ship slips over the horizon, many on the shore would joyfully voice, "There she goes. There she goes." Yet somewhere on the other side of the ocean, there is another harbor. And as that ship appears on their horizon, you can hear them say, "Here she comes. Here she comes." And that was Mary's harbor with King Jesus. And the angels said, "Here she comes. Everybody watch out, Mary's coming." Much like that ship, Mary too has been unmoored from this side of eternity and set free. Set free from all the earthly shore, freed to set sail. And for those who are in Christ Jesus, it is a glorious harbor in the spiritual realm that the scriptures call heaven, where we shall see our Lord face to face. As we draw to a close this morning, one last scripture. John 11:25, it says this, as Jesus comforted Martha, her sister Mary, after the loss of their brother Lazarus, Jesus told her, "I am the resurrection and the life. And anyone who believes in me will live even after dying." That's what Jesus said to two grieving sisters. Anyone who believes in me, even after dying, will live. And as Christians, we have this assurance given to us by Jesus. And he gave that assurance to Mary and Martha. And we have that assurance. I have that assurance. All who believe have that assurance. And we can take comfort in that. I fulfill what Mary asked me to do. She asked me to preach the gospel to those watching online and to those in the building. And I invite you, whether you're watching online or in the building, to consider the words that I've spoken to you today. Jesus is calling you to give your life to him. There's a scripture that says today is the day of salvation. And often we will put things off and think, maybe I'll do it later. Age 16, I decided that I wasn't going to go to church anymore, but I'm going to come back when I'm 50. I'll give my life to you then, Jesus. So I've got another 20 years yet. Didn't get that, did you? But age 16, the existential questions that I was asking about life. What am I doing here? What's the purpose of life? What happens when I die? These were the existential questions that I was asking, and everyone in this building is asking or has asked. And as a pastor, Shane has already said, it's only through Christ that we will find salvation. So what does it require for you to do? It requires for you to ask Jesus to come into your life. That's all it requires for you to do, and to put your trust in him. So I'm just going to pray for us before we close off the meeting this morning. And let me just say, if you've got any other questions, come and talk to me. But most of all, talk to Paul, who's an evangelist. And I bumped into Paul a couple of weeks ago. I was coming out the gym, and Paul was walking up, and I said, Paul, what are you doing? He says, I've just been giving out tracts, Pastor. I've been telling people about Jesus. Even with the grieving of his dear wife, he still went to tell people about Jesus. Man of God. Let us pray. So, Father, I thank you for this family. I thank you for the life of Mary. I thank you for her legacy. I thank you for the impact that she left in so many lives. And her memory will live on in our hearts. And Lord, I look forward to the day when I will see Mary again. And we will see the loved ones who've passed and gone, who put their faith in Jesus. And I pray for everyone in this place that, Father God, they would connect with you, because your love for them is everlasting. I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Just to say, there is a box at the back, and any money that's raised within that goes to Macmillan New Cross Hospital in Mary's memory. And Paul said the way they cared for Paul and Mary while she was in there was exemplary. Let's all stand together, shall we, as we close this part of our meeting.
I love you, Lord. What?